Okay, so hope you guys can see the screen. Can you please let me know whether it's possible for you guys to see my screen?
Yes, sir, we can see. Nice,
guys. Thank you. All right, so let's start with the today's content. So we are actually learning today this platform or this technology called Docker. Actually, Docker is a product, but still the underlying technology is called container technology. So this is something very valuable when it comes to that. In general, I think R&D developers, web developers, whoever in software engineering, plus whoever interested in infrastructure development, cloud and all that, do use Docker as one of the core technologies, right? So the roots of Docker technology comes from virtualization, you know, as we commonly call it as VMs, virtual machines. So it has its roots in that. And also there were several containerized technologies initially, mostly biased or based on Linux platform. But now, of course, we can do it on Windows as well and also macOS. But co-discipline would be on Linux platform, right? And that's a drastic difference between containers and virtual machines and operating systems work. So we need to have the basics of that also in this lesson, or not only on this lesson, but this lesson series or lecture series, you will be learning all the basics of it. So some of you probably already aware about this, but if you are not, don't worry. And even some basics of Linux, I will teach you on the lab series, right? So even though we haven't started it, I will upload the content, then you can log in and by your own, right? So it's very important to understand where this technology stands. It's very important because nowadays, almost every development house do use something related, either Docker or any other technology related, they'll be using. So yes, so it's very interesting for even us to study about it. Right, to start with, so we have to understand, I'm bringing in some pictures from a different page. So let me paste it here. Right, so hope you guys can see it. It's too big. And end of the session, you will get this note as well. So that's the value of this one. All right, so initially we have to understand containers versus virtual machines. So maybe like, okay, we have to start with the difference between virtual machines and operating system. So so I think that probably all of you have learned. So anytime stop me and ask questions, right? But anyhow, these virtual machines are, of course, computers, operating systems developed virtually, right? So they use a concept called hypervisor. As you can see here in this right-hand side picture, the infrastructure is there, and on top of that, you build up hypervisor. So hypervisor is a layer of virtualization, as we say, and basically any hypervisor will built on top of this infrastructure. So this infrastructure can be the normally we called as a host operating system. Host is what is already there. So as you know, then the guest would be whatever get installed. So think about your own computer. I think you probably had run a virtual machine anytime. So because these days, these are very common things for your maybe office work or maybe for your learning and teaching. So probably you'd have implemented one. So we commonly implement things like Ubuntu or even Kali Linux for practicals, right? So there you need to have this hypervisor. So there are many providers of hypervisors. VirtualBox is a free provider. And then you have VMware, we have enterprise level, enterprise grade hypervisors. So, and of course there are many other hypervisor implementers. So in Linux, there are purely open source ones as well, like free and open source ones, they are, we can use, right? So this is not a very new technology. And then of course, using a hypervisor on top of that, you can build your operating system, your virtual machine. So then the difference would be, there'll be a guest OS, as you can see. I think it's visible to you. So it's, that's a guest OS. So why do you need a guest? Because now it's completely a virtualized environment. So this VMA can be Windows, which doesn't have any idea about the infrastructure even exist. Right? So hypervisor basically mask it. Hypervisor is hanganawa virtual machine me infrastructure. So they need to have a different operating system. And say I can run another operating system. So of course, one of the biggest issues or disadvantages of virtual machines is that you need to buy a separate license. So with all open source, yes, you don't have to buy. But of course, service arrangements, you might have to get a subscription service. And also this uses a lot of resources. Now, as an example, ground up, they have a complete operating system here in this virtual machine. Here also, there's another one. So there you are running actually altogether four operating systems, including the host. So if you have 32 GB memory, so you'll be consuming a lot of them. And also performance-wise also, this can be a bit slower. Why? Because it uses a lot of resources by their own. So there's not much shared resource. So hope it's clear to you guys. And then jumping into containers, rather than waiting for so long to understand containers, Docker is the example. Right? So Docker is a company who been involved in containers from day one. So they have been doing really great, or they are even right now, they're doing great in the industry. So here the difference is, of course, you have the infrastructure, and then there's no hypervisor, as it says, right? Okay, that's a question. So in Docker situation, what you have is on top of host operating system, that can be your Windows machine, that can be your Linux machine, or even in my case, I'm using a MacBook and I'm using the Mac iOS, right? So Mac OS. So there on top of that, I can implement this layer called Docker. So actually it's another, I would say it's a kernel. It's like a part operating system. It's a kernel which I have to implement. So Docker does all those complexities. And end of the day, what I have to do is implement those containers on top of that kernel layer. In the, hereafter, we say Docker. This is the example that we are learning. Because of that, I remember Docker is just a product, right? They are giving it for free, but it's a product from a particular company. But there are many more products out there if you wanted to use. And Docker, hereafter Docker, right? So Docker basically now provides that virtualization layer where, it's a virtualization. It looks like a container, it just looks like an application itself. But truly what happens here is it's a container, right? Container where you'll have your own unique environment developed within this container. And here also, you can have a unique environment developed in this container B. And the advantage of containers over virtual machines is that you don't need to use different operating system all the time. I hope now you are clear about it, because you don't have to, right? Because you are just using this host operating system as your main operating system. So you are just making application level calls to work with this host operating system. And also because you don't need to load all those guest operating system plugins, libraries and all that, this works much faster. So that also you have to understand. This works much faster. So, and also performance wise, even security wise, there can be major improvements that you can do. But of course, containers can be more vulnerable than virtual machines because if you attack this host operating system, you'll understand all containers will lose its stance, right? So you gotta be careful. So there are several aspects that you can do on containers. Like as an example, you should not allow the root user to run on a container. Likewise, there are several other, different, when you build a container, there are different ways of building it. So likewise, you can use different techniques on securing your containers as well. And also end of the day, you have to have proper routing, secure routing and all that. Also, you have to have lockdown of your host operating system as well whenever they need. So I think it's clear. And there was a question where somebody has asked a difference between host and the hypervisor. So hypervisor is just a layer of virtualization, right? So we can even look at a research paper later on how this being built. But this is a little bit complex and off topic for our class. But anyway, we can look at how these hypervisors are built. So basically, you have to have a host OS, but there can be situations where there might not be direct host OSs in the case of like enterprise grade implementation. So the VMware and all that, they can directly implement their hypervisor on top of bare bone hardware. But we use it when to our models, like specifically when we do it our in our own case. So this is a little bit different how we do it, right? Hope it's clear for you guys. Okay. So any questions up to this point? Any clarification that you want to make? Yes.
One question, sir. Now within containers, sir, like even within containers, we run an operating system, right? Sometimes if we install something like Ubuntu within the container,
you can. Of course, you if you want, you can use your own operating system on top of container. We can even do it and see. Not to worry. So it's up to you. How do you build up your container model? So there are some rules as well. As an example, you can run another Ubuntu box on top of another operating system as a container. That's not of much value that you're getting because it can be very bulky and all that. So there are like a bit of lighter weight operating system like Alpine. So we look at that. We can implement that as well. Hope the answer is clear.
Yes, thank you.
Right, so here it says Docker container platform is always running on top of the host. Containers are contained in the binaries, libraries, and the application itself. And containers don't contain guest operating system, which ensures the containers are lightweight. So like you said, if you want, you can run an operating system, but you have to make it lightweight as possible. Otherwise, there's no use. Right. But for your practicals and other things, rather than implementing a virtual machine, you can quickly install the container, which have the unique value as well. In contrast, VMs, now we talked about it. So this note I will share you. So I can share this note after the session. So you guys can keep this note in Docker, sorry, in Notion. Only what you need is Notion to look at my note. Right. Okay. So let's then understand about how basically you can build your images. So in a Docker image, so there can be several content. So this is what we are looking at in case of an image. Right, so as you can see, in a Docker image contains everything need to run an application. So this includes a code, runtime, libraries, environment variables, configuration files, and then whatever else that you need. So now just imagine for a moment when you're building up the application, right? So say you are using MemeStack or MernStack. So now you build up that application taking a long time with configurations, and then of course, different type of library and dependencies. So now you have it in your computer. Now for some reason, you have to work on a different laptop. Now again, you have to do all those tedious tasks of running your, installing your things, copying your code. So it takes long time. So Docker comes to the help in that case. So today we'll try our best to develop this small build also, how we can use a Docker container to ease your work. Now, as an example, if you're doing a project, which is a machine learning based project, so what you might need would be, say, a Linux based OS, and then probably some tools, libraries, and so you can build that one. So it's easy to do, use a Docker container in this way. So let's see how to build one as well. And also we'll get to know how to install Docker and how to basically set up that environment also, which is important, right? So so there'll be a lot of value by doing this, right? So try to understand without such setup, you might get like really, I would say like it will be not that easy to migrate from one station to another station. Even say for a moment, like you'll find a new user comes in, so that also will end up with a lot of trouble and, you know, issues and all that, right? So this is where you have to be a bit careful, or maybe this is a very good opportunity for you to something like Docker. Okay, so somebody's asking the difference between Docker container and Docker image. So actually we are learning it. So Docker container is basically the final process that runs in your computer. But image is where something that you build, and then you can keep it on a dashboard or a kind of a registry. So we are going to learn about it. So if you go to Docker Hub, which is kind of a registry of Docker images, which you can do is, which you can pull one of those or clone one of those libraries to your own own workstation. So that's the difference. So Docker container is whatever it's up and running. Okay, so let's try to look at how basically we can install Docker. So that's also the important part. So you guys can do it if you want with me, and also just to get a bit of idea about what sort of commands that we can run and things like that. So so just to get familiar with the environment. So let me reshare my desktop. Yes, so now this is the Docker site. If you go to docs.docker.com, sorry, docker.com, get Docker, all these options are available. So remember, if you are using Docker for Linux, that will be the easiest. If you have Ubuntu box as your host box, and then if you can install Linux on top of it, sorry, Docker on top of it, that will be the easiest, because Docker is mainly based on Linux, right? Say now we are going to install Docker on Windows, right? So now, of course, you have to go to these links and check for the requirements. Right. So this is Docker Engine. So yes, so this this is a desktop version. So you can install Docker in your own Linux box or the Windows PC or the Mac OS. Right. So as you can see here, it works on most of the common platforms like in Linux, CentOS, Debian, Fedora. These are the common ones. Even if you get Kali, it's like in Debian. Ubuntu is there. Binaries are there also. So you have few documents there, so that you can read and understand. And Docker in desktop, sorry, Windows can be a bit complex, because Windows natively does not support Docker. So it doesn't support containers in the future maybe. So if you wanted to implement Windows, you have to make sure your Hyper-V is installed. And that's one option, right? So where you have to use this Hyper-V technology, and that can be a bit of a trouble, right? But if you use Windows 10, there's a better option where you can use WSL. So WSL is one of the Linux runtimes enabled in Windows 10. So WSL is another great product. As an example, you can run Kali Linux without using any virtual machine because of the WSL feature. So what you have to do is you have to enable WSL when you are implementing Docker. So make sure that you read all this content before you install it, and then you can start it. Sometimes you get an error end of the day saying WSL is not updated. You have to basically go and do update and restart everything. So then basically you are good to go. So remember, there are two options when you're installing Docker in Windows. Don't get it confused. So one is using this Hyper-V method, which can be a bit confusing, but if you read the documents here, it will not be that difficult to understand. Right, so that is on Windows. And on a Mac, it's much easier. Probably easier than installing Windows, because the installation steps are very easier. That's why. Otherwise, but complexity is there because originally macOS doesn't support something like containers. So they basically, in the desktop version, they install their own unique kernel on top of the product. So basically what it uses is that particular kernel. So yeah. So as you can see, VirtualBox, blah, 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 is not compatible. Yeah, so that is how you do it. So installation is pretty simple. So I'm not going to go through it again and again. Right. Any question about this? So I think it's nothing we have to learn on a lesson like this. So what creating a login would be highly beneficial in Docker, because end of the day, you have to go to Docker Hub. And then, of course, you have to work with this Docker Hub all the time. So it's good to have a create account here. Of course, there are upgrade options, which you don't need to. Right. So then, of course, there are so many previously created Docker images. So this is the question that somebody asked, what are Docker images? So you can download them from here. And when you're downloading them, please be clear that you are downloading verified images, because now here it clearly says from the Docker Hub, it was downloaded 10 million downloads. So which is obviously gives some sort of assurance that this might not contain malware and all that. So likewise, sometimes, yes, you have to look at the whoever, uploaded it. So you can get those details here. And details, when they're updating, they keep up good records as well. So, and documentation, then you can easily decide how you have to use one of those. And there are plenty of them here for many, many reasons, for enterprise reasons. As an example, analytics related boards are there, so images are there. Some are free to use, some are not free to use. So as an example, there are many DevOps tools as well. So Maven and many other Jenkins. So you can simply use them from here. Some of them are open source ones and also security ones. So likewise, there's nothing on security here, but so then of course, any other things like operating systems. So Alpine, so this is the one which is so famous. It's a minimal one, which you can install, easily install. Right, so you guys can also install these things. But people who don't have much enough initial knowledge on that. So there's one called Play with Docker, which is one environment created by open source gurus. So you can use this today also. I'll give you some time for you to practice with this. So after I do my activity, you can come here and do it. And also your lab activities. I have several lab activities which you have to do from this platform, and you have to actually do a video and submit. I'll give you all the details. So actually, this is really great. We've been using it for a very long time. Initially, this was done by a set of people, but now Aureli, one of the biggest learning providers, have acquired this platform called Katacoda. And there are several scenarios which are free to use, which are perfect for you to study and understand how to do. Now, as an example, we are covering Docker and also Kubernetes, and also Linux, of course, and also continuous integration like Jenkins platforms, orchestration again. So yes, some networking and cloud related stuff. All these ones, serverless computing. Yeah, so all these things you can do it here without much like wasting your own CPU resources. But at one point, whatever you selected are very important to you, you better implement in your own PC or Mac or Linux and play around. Right? So there are several platforms like this. These two would be good to start, right? So we will talk about it later, right? So now I think any questions up to this point? Any questions, guys? Hope you guys can hear me.
Is it possible to install Docker in virtual machine, Linux, Fedora, or CentOS?
Yes, that's possible. That's no problem, because a virtual machine itself is, if you have enough resources, nothing stopping you from implementing something like on a virtual box.
That's okay, nah? Then we need memory, or it's we can use the
No. It's like a normal application, but you have to have an idea about how to basically handle your memory. So of course, sometimes they will use a lot of memory, because now you're on a virtual machine, it also uses memory, but it's not impossible to do. But the production environments, you don't do it in that way, unless otherwise you have a great VM platform. So if that is the case, yes, but for a developer, so you need to run your normal PC on top of that, better to run your Dockers. But if you have enough resources for your virtual machines, it's like the normal thing. There's no big difference. But in security perspective, there can be more additions of security issues, because you have more layers now on below your container.
Okay, and any
point for these questions, if you have anything to share with some of you, maybe DevOps engineers, you can just jump in and explain, right? Don't have to wait and listen to my answer, but you can also jump in and help others. So anybody want to give a question, ask a question, or share anything? Your experience, because these are master level classes. So you're more than welcome to share your experience. Right, guys. So anything anyone wants to add? Hope you can see my terminal. No, nothing, no one. Good. Hope everything is clear. So I have actually installed Docker. I'm not going to go to the installation steps, because it's much easier. So really, we don't need to do that. So if you do Docker, so you can get all the details. So let me create another directory. Lesson one. Right. So now if you say Docker, you can get all the details about Docker itself, self-sufficient runtime, blah, blah. And these are some management commands, which are important. You have to learn, right? And then there are other commands like, okay, build, commit, and create. Okay, there are a few other Docker PS, RM, things like that. So next, I will check my version, which is important. So now in Docker, there are two, I would say, elements. One is the client, and the other one is server. So there's something called Docker Engine. So it also works like a client-server model, guys. Bit older, but still works. Client-server model. So we can make it distributed. There are many ways of doing it. Yeah, so but this is the initial format. And the current version is, this is the most important part, 20.10.6. For the Docker Engine, it's 20.10.6, right? And API versions are there. And this is being built from Go language. So the Go version is there, and Git commit numbers are there. So you have to get familiar with Git also, Git, GitHub, Git versioning, and you know all the Git related stuff. So I have several videos created already, which I'm going to share today. You can leisurely go through that and do your content. Right, so that's clear. So then when you check the Docker version, so then what I can do is, I can check whether is there any Docker images already there. So you can say Docker images. Yeah, so these are some of the Docker images. So you can say Docker image dot ls. So still will give the same answer. So two commands, Docker images or Docker image ls. For Linux guys, you know ls is to list. All right. So I have few here. So there's a one tutorial, Docker 1c tutorial here. Which I downloaded 2 months ago. And there are some Docker images, which I downloaded 6 months ago. And there's another tutorial here. So I can, you know, spawn this one also, and I can work with this. I think something that we can learn. And then there's Alpine here. Alpine is Linux OS. And then of course you can do like security stuff also, like cool stuff. There are this, already like develop boxes for security testing. So I have used few of them. So I have few of them already installed or downloaded into my local machine. Then I can type in Docker PS to see whether there's any up and running Docker containers. Now this is the difference between the images and the containers. So there's nothing at the moment. So nothing is running in my Mac. Hope it's clear to you guys. So Docker images would search for the real images files, the PS command. Like this is like processors would give the idea about what Docker containers are running, right? So of course you can, anytime you can pull a Docker image and also you can run also. Now there are two ways that you can do a new version. One is Docker run, as an example. If you look at my images again, I can say Docker run. So that's easier if you don't have this one in your computer. So they will basically download it from the Docker Hub and they will run it. So that is another cool stuff. Yeah, so as you can see, Docker is running, and it's running Alpine Linux, as you can see, right? So it's already started. So I'm not going to run any of this, just wanted to show you this. But if I use another tab, I can show you basic homebrew, a bit of fun. Now if I do a Docker PS, so I should see my one of my containers are running 37 seconds ago. But this guy is still running. It's doing its own work. So I can't remember actually what to do on this tutorial. It can be a web front end or any other. But it's already running. So it has a container ID, as you can see. That's how Unicly identify the ID of the container, or the identification. This is how it ran itself, and it was created 37 seconds ago and up for 36 seconds, and it works with TCP port. So obviously this should be a web-based environment. So let me check whether there's anything running here in 127 or local. Nothing yet. So I can't remember this exactly what's happening here, but later on we can run such tutorials as well. So not a big deal, because we are not really interested in this particular one. So okay, so I exited from it, so I can go and check whether this is running. Now it's not running, right? So yeah, so I hope it's clear to you. So I just exited from that Docker container, so it's no longer running. All right, so I can now do some interesting Docker now, because I don't have something like Nginx, you know, is a web server. So let me check whether I have any image on Nginx. No, right? So I can obviously go to Docker Hub and search for it. Actually, I'm not going to show you how do I run or how do I search for it. I'm in this browser, the terminal. You can also check. It's very simple. You just go and search, and then you are good to implement it. So let me download one. So this is the command. So if you know a good Nginx, I told you earlier, you can go to Docker Hub and find the image. It's not a big deal. So then what you can do is I can actually download this to my own machine, right? So let me run the command. So I would say Docker. Now I can do another command called pull, right? Pull, but I would prefer to do run. So it automatically runs. And then I want to take it to the foreground, or mainly I need to do interact with it. So that's why I use a tag called tag IT, right? Then I can say, I have to give a port for it to run. So I will do 8080, right? So yes, so the default port also would be 84 Nginx. So I'm going to now say, okay, download Nginx, right? So now let's go through the command itself. So Docker run command is, of course, as you know, it's very interesting and important, because it will run if the Docker image is there in the PC, right? Is that clear? It's in the PC. Otherwise, it will pull it from the Docker Hub, right? And then, guys, IT says for interactive mode, right? So it will not go to the background. And also 8080, it's like minus P is like for the port. 80 container, that external port 80, because Nginx server by default is running on port 80. And then able to send HTTP request to the server from our local machine by opening the URL. So I will show it to you. I will share this other tutorial also I'm looking at. So you guys can surely go through it, but that's not a big deal here, but it's very easy. Right. And then, so let's do it and see how it works. So now it checks, and it says it's unable to find Nginx, the latest one. So actually pulling from the Docker Hub, you can see it's downloading now. So let's see how it goes to work on. Give it a bit of a time. Yeah, so it's saying build and Linux and start worker processors. Yeah, so now it says blah 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 messages, and okay, so it says now go to localhost.slash, which I'm going to do. Let me share my full screen for a moment. It'll be easier for you to see it. Right. So let me share it here. So I type in localhost. So now you can see, of course, welcome to Nginx. In if the C page, Nginx web service successfully installed and working. Further configuration. So of course you can do rest of the configuration without any problem. Right. So at this particular point, if I go to my homebrew and say Docker PS, so obviously you can see there's a new container ID, and then this container is running. And this is this 000 means the local, and port 80, and the external one is 80. So that's created by this guy called Noti Format. Right. So that's fine. In case if you want to delete this one, right? So you can of course go here and say control X or something, but you can do Docker RM, right? So Docker RM, and you can give the container ID, right? So that's another neat way of killing it easily. Okay, you cannot run in container, stop the container. Okay, so you have to stop it. So maybe like I can go here and control C, control X, control C, right? Then I can, I think, do it easily here. Yeah, so that's fine. Now if I go to Docker RM, that's no nothing there. And do Docker PS, Docker PS, that's nothing running here. But if I now say Docker, Docker image ls, so you should be able to see the Nginx because they have installed it. Yes, exactly. So next time just say Nginx, Docker run Nginx, that's it, done. So if you want to interact, you have to say dash IT, tag IT. And so it's not a big size as well. Now you can see this is 133 MB, but you know this one, it's a little bit bigger because it might have so many other installations on it. So we have to be a bit careful on, like, you know, really, is it a good thing to run these things and all that with big sizes? So it's up to you, like, depending on your needs. Right. So as you understood, if you have to go out, you have to say Control C, and then you can remove it, right? And of course, if you want to remove an image, that's also is possible. So I want to clean up my machine a bit because it's taking a lot of space. So I think I don't need this Tomcat 623 something, this Tomcat server. So I can just get the image ID, guys, and copy, and I can say paste here. So okay. Unable to find, can I just okay, so it might be using something else. So let me remove this another one. Open, okay, MobFF. Okay, maybe I don't need this one. Let me check whether I can remove this one directly. Vivo, maybe it doesn't have any dependencies. Okay. I think I have to type images. Okay. I think it should work. Anyway, so this is the command. So there can be a few other, maybe tag to use or latest. No, okay, that probably we had to. Tag should be latest. It's one argument. Okay, that's fine. So just you can try it out later. I'm not going to waste my time on that one. Right. So I hope now it's clearer. There are many other Docker related commands, like if you wanted to do detach containers and adding names for containers. So these are practice, actually. Really, there's no big value of learning this here in this lesson. You can practice it, of course. There are so many practicals available in Katacoda. You can do them. As an example, how to bind to a new Docker image and things like that, share one in Docker Hub. So those things are not really, really difficult to do. So let's try to then, we can take 5 minutes, 6 minutes. You can also try this out. I would prefer if you try it out and see whether the issues that you're getting. And then we can try out doing something very interesting to build a Docker image, right? From the scratch, and we'll see how it works out. Okay, guys, take 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes maximum. Just try doing it in your own local machine. And if you don't have enough resources, I would highly recommend you to go here, go over to labs.playwithdocker or play with Docker. And it's very simple. If you just connect it with your login, you can say add new instance. And then you get your machine, right? So what you have to do is here, you can see this. You can do the same commands that which I used earlier, a Docker version, right? And you can search for Docker image ls. Okay, there's nothing here. So what you can do is you can pull one to this side, Docker pull, and then Docker run, and do the Nginx one, install it and try it out. This is a bit slower than you are doing it locally. But try to do it and see whether you are comfortable with all the commands and things like that. I'll give you 10 minutes. Start now, guys.
sir.
okay, everyone. Did you manage to try it out? Was it okay? Right. So, like I told you earlier, it's better if you don't have your machine capacity to do anything, just do it in the play with Docker one or Katacoda one. Both is more than sufficient for you to get the knowledge, right? So now what we should do, let me share my screen again. Let me try to build something on Docker and then try to use it as a Docker build. So that's also important. So let me share my screen. So you guys can do this using some editor IDE, right? So let me try to develop this one on Visual Studio Code, right? I think you probably have used this one. People who have never used this one, just download it. It's very simple code editor. You can go to code.visualstudio.com, right? And you can download this. Right. So it'd be easier to use something like this. But remember, guys, the whole point is just to understand this, how this concept works. But you will learn all these things later on, right? So don't really worry too much about this, right? So just here we wanted to work on this principle. Right. Can you guys see my screen again?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Okay, so we can create a file here. So of course we can have a JavaScript file, right? So we can have a very simple JavaScript command. It doesn't matter which is which, right? So it's a very simple idea here. Hello world, hello from. First, just give me a second. I'm getting a call, please. So you can write the JavaScript code and you can from first Docker build 101 or something. So that is a JavaScript file. So it's very easy. And then I think we need to build up something called a Docker file, right? So Docker file is a configuration file, which basically can develop all this necessary configuration to do a build. So let me start a new file called Docker file. So you have to make sure to type it right. So as you can see, when you say Docker file with the capital D, it automatically take it as a Docker file. And yeah, so that's fine, but there is a small issue, it seems. Yeah, so maybe I have not installed the needed extension. So if it is the case, you can always go to extensions. As you can see the extensions, there are extensions installed, extensions are there. Yeah, so this is already installed, so not a big deal. So let me search for Docker file. Is there anything else needs to get installed here? No, nothing more. So I think that will work out. So let me go to my space again. Right, so let's, okay, it seems okay. Let's work on that, right? So basically now what I'm going to do, I'm going to run a JavaScript file. So that's my idea. So a JavaScript file on top of Linux OS, right? And then of course, on top of that, I need a server version like JavaScript server engine like Node.js. So that's what I'm going to do. So of course, initially in a Docker file, I need to select a platform. I think you can see what I'm typing here. So I need a platform like Linux, right? So there are several Linux platforms here which you can use, right? There's Linux, like as an example, you can see you can get Debian, you can get something like Travis. So there are many Linux OSs. I would like to use Linux Alpine here. Why? Because it's very simpler in nature. It's like, it's not very, very bulky, right? So that way it's much better, right? So this is something that you can do initially, right? So there are so many different methods that we can use here. So it's up to you to decide how to work it on, right? So, but otherwise you can even use something direct like Node itself, where it will automatically create whatever necessary internal OS as well. So it's up to you to decide on different methods, how you can build this container of yours or contain image of yours, right? So there's a lot of things that you can consider when you're doing this. So let me do it in a different, bit of a different way rather than using directly Alpine here. So as I told you, let me do something bit different. So I can say I'm going to install Node, right? So that makes sense. And of course, here I can say I wanted to get Node with Alpine itself. So that will be easier, right? To do things, right? Of course, you can understand because so when you work with this, you can see there are many formats. Okay, so you can find out many other formats as well. So you can use one of them. So it's up to you to do that. And then of course I need to get the files. So I need to use the command called copy command. So I can get it from anywhere, right? So I can get it from anywhere, right? So if it is in the same directory, I can take files from there. The source file here, only the app.js file. And that has to go into a directory called app directory, right? So hope that command is clear. So whatever the files here, which is just this app.js file, that's all, right? And you have to just copy it to the app directory. So it's very simple. Or you can specify whatever the files that you want to use as well. Okay. So hope you guys can see my screen. I'm writing very small fonts. Is that clear, everyone? Pena dogolanta meka hariyata?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then it's good. Okay, thank you. All right. So then actually what I have to do is I have to say what to run, right? So what application or what code to run. So here, of course, I have to specify which program to run. So I can say command, I want to run something in the app directory, and then I wanted to run app.js. So this is something that I can run, right? So you can specify the work directory and you can run it. Of course, it's when you are running this, you have to give the command, which is node command, because that is what we are running in our terminal as well, right? So if you have the system all built in our computer, this is the command that you would run. But if you want, you can say, what is my work directory? So this is very important when it comes to dealing with bigger program. So I can say app is my work directory. So then even I don't have to use that app thing anymore, because it knows exactly where to find my code. Right. So hope this is clear up to this point. So for commands only up to this point on my Docker file. Is that clear, guys? All good? All good up to this?
Yes, it's clear.
Okay. So what we have done, we have, I think we don't need the semicolon here. We did a very simple JavaScript file, and then we did the Docker file as well to do the configurations, right? So still people are coming, right? Okay, right. So that's fine. Okay, now what we should do, I think we should do the build. So for that, I can go to the terminal. So let's go and see. What are they? Look at, just give me a second. Okay, give me a second, guys. Okay, so now I can see my files here. So what I can do is now I can build a Docker image. So I have to say build or Docker build. Okay, Docker build. And I have to say minus T to put a tag. I would say hello db.js, something like that. And what I have to say is I have to get all the files from this directory. So let's do it. Okay. Okay. Fail to create LLB definition. Docker file cannot be empty. Maybe I have not saved it. Let me check. I think I saved it. Okay. Let me do it again. Oh, that's great. It's doing its work. It might take a bit of a time because it has to download all the stuff, guys. I think you are aware that it has to, even though it's a very simple, it looks like a very simple program, guys. It's not a very simple one because it has to download all the stuff and, you know, build the image with Node.js and everything. Okay. Hope it's clear. So please ask if you have any questions about what just that happened, right? Hope it should be
clear. Yes, sir, I have a question though.
Yeah, but yes.
So when you're creating this image, actually you are saying to use the host OS, right? Rather, you know, installing a new one into the image.
No. What I'm doing is I'm creating an image here. You understand?
No, what I'm saying is, you know, the host OS, I mean, it's using the host OS, right? Rather adding a lightweight OS into the image.
No. Here, because when I selected Node, I selected Alpine. So actually it's creating a lightweight image.
Okay, so basically Node itself, you know, installing a lightweight OS.
Exactly. So now see, if you look at this repository, as you can see, it's it follows 112 MB. So it has this Node plus other things. You understand?
Okay. So it's basically downloading a lightweight OS as well, right, sir?
Exactly. The one called Alpine.
Right. So, I mean, it's still possible, right? If you need to say that, you know, just to use the host OS. And it is also doable, right?
Yes, of course. Why not?
It's okay. Doable.
But here, now the thing is, like, there are a lot of very interesting combinations here when you are in working conditions, right? So you might be working very different types of software stack. So this depends on company to company. We will try to get our experience also. Mama dana metana innawa docker karana kattiya. So you can share your knowledge next week. So about how you set up your images. So different techniques, best practices. Tamara katte security on hinda security handle karana widiyata me docker kali kali kadala compose ekin hadanne. ඒ වගේ දේවල් තියෙනවා ගොඩක් ඉන්ට්‍රෙස්ටිං ඒවා. So අපි ඒවා මේ මම ගන්නවට හොඳයි මේ ඉන්ඩස්ට්‍රි වැඩ කරන කට්ටිය ලැබුවම ඉගෙන ගන්න එක. So we'll try to work it out. I think let me know. I'll put a message to everyone who can teach that in the next week session. So we can do it better. Now what
yeah,
we can
sure,
do?
Thanks.
Yeah, sure. Thanks. So now we can add this to, if needed, we can add this to Docker Hub. And from there, we can download it to our Docker playbook. එකට දාලා බලන්න පුළුවන් ඔයගොල්ලන්ට. හරිද ඒකත් හරිම ඉන්ට්‍රෙස්ටිං වැඩක් මොකද අපේ ෆස්ට් ටයිම් අපේ ඩොකර් ඉමේජ් එකක් අපිට දාන්න පුළුවන් මේ කොහෙටද අපේ මෙහෙට රයිට් මෙහෙට කියලා කියන දස් ගන්න ඩොකර් හබ් එකට රයිට් සෝ නැත්තම් මට රන් කරලා බලන්න පුළුවන් නම් මේක ඩොකර් රන් බලන්න මොකද වෙන්නේ කියලා අර මගේ JS කෝඩ් එකේ අවුලක් තිබුණ නැත්තම් මේක වැඩ කරන්න ඕනේ මං හිතන්නේ ලොකු අවුලක් නම් තිබ්බේ නැහැ නේ යා හරිනේ මේකනේ hello from fest මම ගන්න තේරෙන්නේ නැති වෙච්ච දේ මොකද්ද කියලා එතන මේ ඉමේජ් එක පුෂ් කරලා වන්නම් මම ඩොකර් හබ් එකට පුෂ් කරලා ඉවෙලා අපේ මෙතන ඩවුන්ලෝඩ් කරලා බලන්නත් පුළුවන් ඉතින්. ඒතකොට වෙන මැෂින් එක මේක කිසිම ගැටලුවක් නැතුව මෙන්න මෙතන රන් වෙනවා කියලා පෙන්වන්න පුළුවන්. ඩොකර් හබ් එකට පුෂ් කරන්න තියෙන්නේ මේක. ඉතින් මේ විදිහට අපිට try කරලා බලන්නත් පුළුවන්. හැමෝටම clear ද කතාව? ඒකයි මම කරන්න එක ලේසි පොඩි වැඩක් තියෙන්නේ. හැබැයි ඒක කරලා බලන්න. එතකොට ඕගලන්ට it's like very interesting the whole process being done. I think now this is a big thing because මේක මේ හරි ඉන්ට්‍රෙස්ටිං දේවල් ඕන තරම් තියෙනවා කරන්න පුළුවන් දේවල් මේ you guys can build this in a very very different ways හරි complex system develop කරන්න පුළුවන් මේකෙන් so you have to learn lot more about the docker file මොකද ඒකෙත් there's lot of learning there so in that way guys you can learn a lot actually right so truly you can learn a lot so if you are really really interested so if you go to docker hub so where's my docker hub So I can even upload this image to the registry, and then I can create my own repository, right? My content. So then, basically, anybody can download it. So yeah. So only thing is, like, I think I need to have some, So create a repository, and then I can say Docker push. So this is the one. So I can put a tag, right? So and then I can push the new repo with the tag name. It will come here. Then I can make it public. And then that's done. No, that's done. So we can try it out also if you wants to. Let me try it out. Okay. So I have the image. Let me Docker tag local image. So that is hello hello db.js. And I can tag it like hello js slit right and I can give a name it's the same thing again hello db js and then I can give the tag name hello js slit okay no such image Okay, so this should be latest. Sorry. Okay, that's done. So then I had to push this Docker push hello. All right, type it db.js and the tag name hello js slit. Okay. It's very mistake. No? Sorry about it. Yeah. Okay. I think I have to set up all the username and password. So you can do this process. I'm not going to put any more time into that. So you guys can do that. And then of course, once you have this one as a public repo, and it's very simple one of trying it out on different PC or different setup. Okay, so that's very simple. So we'll not go there. So in summary, today we learn what is Docker, what are containers, what basically we can do from Docker, and what are the basic Docker commands. and also how to build something in a development environment, which is the most important example for, I think, most of you. And of course, for your learning purposes, to have your own computer, whatever, interactive learning Linux box or whatever, you can create it here as well. So there are so many options, guys, nothing to worry. Yeah, so I think now we should practice it, and I'll upload these things today, and you guys can work on these things. Right, any questions, guys? Any questions?
Sir, one question, sir. Now, when pulling a new image, sir, it's sort of pulling in layers, right, with different SHA things. So what are those, sir, exactly?
Good question. Now, because now this is something very, very, very careful. Now, in a Docker build image, this should clearly mention what should get installed, like from bottom to top. First the OS, then the other one. So when you do these Docker builds, like, you have to specifically mention the order as well. So in this particular example, what get built would be, you get the Linux kernel installed, and then it will run, and of course Node.js would be there, and then you run the application. That's what happens. But to make these lives easier, there is a method called Docker Compose, which you're going to learn next week, and so that will ease the work.
Thank you.
Perfect. Anyone wants to share anything? I really value if you can share some of your thoughts about this thing.
So one thing, sir, when you come to the downloading process, even though we have layers, so good thing is, let's say we have a 200 MB machine size, but if some components are in our machine, so it's reducing the download time as well. For example, if kernel is available with other images, it won't download the kernel.
Oh, okay.
And it reuses the host kernel as well.
Understood.
And if you want to, integrate multiple components, like, app server, DB server, and multiple, API servers, so we can use the Docker Compose. So again, one file, so multiple, images, we can combine all together and create a, different environment in our local machine. And so one good thing, this is my experience when we, we started, creating Docker, because we had a big problem when we are deploying, developer machine all working every time, but when we are doing the deployment, sometimes the environment not working, production environment not working, environment specific problems we had because of the library issues. Most of the Node.js and Python, there are a lot of versions in common libraries. So if we have this kind of containers, we don't need to worry about installing all those stuff, because it's already we have images containerized. So we just need to use the container which developed by developers.
Thanks a lot, Pasindra.
Yeah, thank you.
That's like the highlight anyway, so I couldn't mention that here. So when you have Node.js itself, there are so many versioning, so when different teams works together, this can make a lot of complexity. So Docker would simply solve that problem. So if somebody like Pasindu can share some of his work next week, probably can demonstrate something, that would be great. If you have time, set up something and I'll give the time for you guys to. And anyway, we are going to work on Docker Compose as well. Because we are going to cover a lot of materials in the DevOps lecture series, we are not going deep dive into most of the areas. But we'll try to do it on the lab session. So where I will have several videos, already hosted videos mostly, but you can do it and submit like a homework sort of. Okay, guys, thank you so much. And let's make this week, the Monday, I will make sure that the GitHub labs are available. So I will have someone, or maybe me, just there. If you want to ask questions, you can do, but that time involve, try to get those things done. And I will make a submission link for you to just to upload some video of what we have done. Okay, that's great. Thank you so much for joining in. So next week we can work on the rest of the Docker, which are important. And we might try to host a Docker Clubhouse as well again. So we couldn't, last week I had to not to do the class. So yeah, we'll do that. And Docker constraints, of course, we can discuss that, Dinuka. Like, there are a few actually. We can work on that as well, because That's where the things like Kubernetes also comes in. So we will talk about those things next week. And also next week, we'll start the intro into the Kubernetes as well, orchestration and how things go ahead from that point onwards. And there are a lot of interesting research work done in the industry as well as academia on these areas, which is perfect, right? Okay, so have a nice day. Take care. Don't wait until, don't blame government. We had to blame ourselves about the COVID situation. So we had to make sure we do have enough things been done. Right, otherwise this won't help at all. So yeah, so be careful and take care always. Thank you so much, guys.
Thanks,
thank you, sir.